All right, Scott's going to lead us in Psalm 8 here in just a little bit, so let's sing some songs that have that theme. So number 25 in my book, but O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name, but not the O Lord, our Lord version. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. O Lord, we praise your name. O Lord, we magnify your name. Prince of Peace, mighty God. O Lord God Almighty. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. O Lord, we praise your name. O Lord, we magnify your name. Prince of Peace, mighty God. O Lord God Almighty. Now let's sing Fairest Lord Jesus. After this song, will you pray for us, please?
Fairest Lord Jesus, ruler of all nature, O thou of God and man the Son, thee will I cherish, thee will I honor, thou my soul's glory, joy, and crown. Fair are the meadows, fairer still the woodlands, robed in the blooming garden. Jesus is fairer, Jesus is purer, who makes the woeful heart to sing. Fair is the sunshine, fair. Jesus shines brighter, Jesus shines purer than all the angels heaven can boast. Beautiful Savior, Lord of the
Father, we thank you so much for Jesus who shines bright in our lives. Your word which illuminates the path for us. The great guidance we have from the scriptures and from the actions of Jesus on this earth who gave himself with love to save all those who would want to be saved. Even those who hated him at the time, and even like Paul who persecuted his children. We are amazed at your grace. We thank you for it, Father. And Father, in these trying times, we pray that the church may focus on Jesus the Christ and the power of heaven, and that we might choose those directions you would want us to go, with righteousness, loving our neighbors, caring for our neighbors, and trying to bring them closer to the Lord Jesus Christ. We pray for those who are ill in this congregation, who are battling trauma or trouble, or even weakness of spirit. We pray that they may be encouraged by our love and our words and our deeds. Help us, bless us, Father, as we worship you tonight. And we pray that you will hear our prayers tonight in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Okay, we're in Psalm 8. I've got one or two more things to say about Psalm 1. We're just doing selected psalms, maybe like my favorite psalms or something like that. It's kind of like a songbook, isn't it? Look in Psalm 1. We're going to wrap up kind of the negative side of Psalm 1. Not so the wicked. We looked at the righteous last week, the righteous one who is like a tree planted by streams of living water. Think of the deeply rooted tree that regardless of how long the famine lasts or how strong the wind blows, that tree will stand because it's planted by the streams of living water. And those streams of living water are the delight that the righteous man has in the law of the Lord. But not so the wicked. They are like chaff that the wind blows away. I can't say that I'm a farmer or that I fully understand or have been around wheat and chaff. I think I can envision it. I think I understand the idea. Here's how I understood the idea of chaff. I decided I was really kind of getting into coffee, and I thought the only thing left for me to learn how to do is roast my own beans. I guess I could grow my own beans, but I'm not sure how that would go. But I can roast my own beans, so I get these raw beans, and I cook them in a popcorn popper and just keep them circulating, and they turn like shiny, oily, brownish black. And then they're so hot, and I take them, and I throw them up and catch them, and throw them up and catch them. And you throw it up, and this little skin that was on the bean just goes straight up into the air and blows away. And what's left is a bean that's shaken free of its little husk, of its little chaff. And I mean, that stuff is gone, never to be seen again. That chaff is blown away, like the wicked. The chaff that gets blown away. You take the wheat grain and you throw it up, and the little skin husk gets taken by the wind, and then there's something that remains. There's something that remains, but not the chaff. Now think of the contrast between the rooted, deep-rooted, righteous man, the tree that will not be blown away and whose leaf does not wither and who bears fruit. How stable, how immovable is the righteous man, and the wicked man is... What's the most opposite thing in nature? Like chaff. It does not stand. It does not remain. And it says, therefore the wicked, you remember we talked about the righteous the righteous will not walk, the righteous will not sit, the righteous will not, the righteous will not walk, the righteous will not stand, the righteous will not sit in the seat of mockers. Well, the wicked will not stand either. The wicked will not stand in judgment. When judgment comes, that's kind of like the threshing floor. Judgment is the threshing floor. And your deeds will find us out. And we go through the judgment, and that which is true remains, and that which is wicked is like the chaff. And that wicked one will not stand in judgment. The judgment will blow the wicked away. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. So there's two ways, there's two paths. As we set up this whole songbook, there's two paths. There's the path of the righteous, and there's the path of the wicked. And this psalm warns and invites one to the path of the righteous. Warns one against the path of the wicked and invites one to the path of the righteous. Now let's look at Psalm 8. Psalm 8 is such a rich, beautiful psalm. I fear I may dwell here a while. Let's study this song. If you have a Bible or are able to see the whole psalm, you'll notice something about it. Just kind of look at the whole lyric from beginning to end. Sort of an invitation to worship, maybe an invocation, and then a benediction at the end of worship. So we begin with, O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. And then we end with, O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You notice the first and the last verse are the same. And so this is a psalm about the majesty of God. And so the bookends of this beautiful song are the majesty of God, a praise to the Lord for his majesty. And then in between, we see what that majesty is like. We get to sort of unpack or define the majesty of God. And it's sort of surprising what the marks or the description of majesty that we find in Psalm 8. Let's look a little bit more at these invocation, benediction, the beginning and end of this psalm. O Lord, our Lord. So notice your Bible probably punctuates, capitalizes these words differently. There's two Lords. And in the Hebrew Bible, these would be two different, these would actually be two totally different words with different letters. They wouldn't look alike at all. But in the English, we don't know quite what to do with that. O Lord, our Lord. The first one is the name of God. That's the capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D. When you see that, that's an indication that the word behind that is Yahweh, the name of the Lord. The name of the Lord, which the root of it has something like I am. It goes back to when God was, Moses asked, well, who should I say sent me? And he says, I am. The one who is, he just is, he always is, and he always will be, and always has been. I am. The name of the Lord. So, as we think of the personal name of God, Yahweh, and then we also think of his reign and his lordship and his rule and our allegiance to him as Lord. We go with the name of the Lord. We go with the position of the Lord. O Lord, who is our Lord, how majestic is your name. Going back to the first word of the psalm. Your name is majestic in all the earth. And it just follows as you just continue with this praise. You have set your glory above the heavens. Now, it's such a strange transition here, verse 2. You have set your glory above the heavens. The one who is, the great I am. How majestic is your name. You've set your glory above the heavens. You're transcendent. You're beyond our reach. And your radiance is beyond the heavens. And now look at this. From the lips of children and infants, you have ordained, you're translation will have a little option here. You have ordained strength or praise. Strength goes with the Hebrew translation of the Old Testament, the Hebrew Old Testament, and praise is the Greek translation of the Hebrew. So your English doesn't quite always know what to do with it. And so it'll tell you, it'll give you a little footnote to say, or strength or praise. It depends on if you're translating from the Hebrew or the Greek. From the lips of children and infants, you have ordained strength because of your enemies to silence the foe and the avenger. As I read this, and I read it over and over, it's not intuitive to me what this is talking about. Like, I needed commentators to help me with this one. And I'm still not sure I got the help I needed. From the lips of children and infants, you have ordained strength because of your enemies to silence the foe and the avenger. You know what it almost seems like? Is that God has set his glory in the heavens, he's transcendent, he's majestic. And then also, little babies, little weak, helpless babies display the strength as well and the majesty of God. In fact, they're piercing, this is what I thought of, their piercing cry. You know a cry of a baby? It buckles the knees of any stout human being. It brings the avengers to their knees. I don't think that's what it's talking about, but that was my first take at it. I think it's talking about, well, if you go with the Greek translation, the children and the infant seem to grasp the glory and the majesty of God, and they shame the avengers and the enemies of God. They display the beauty and the majesty of God. They seem to have, even though they are weak and without knowledge, without vast knowledge, they seem to have intuitively something that the enemies of God lack. Jesus does something with this that does help interpret it Christologically. Look at Matthew chapter 22. Matthew 22. So this is when he's coming in the into Jerusalem. This is the triumphant entry. Matthew 21, I'm sorry. He's coming into Jerusalem, and people are singing praises to him. Let's look at chapter 21, verse 1. As they approached Jerusalem, came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and once you find a donkey tied there with her colt by her, untie them, bring them to me." This is all a fulfillment of a prophecy in Zechariah. If anyone says anything to you, tell him that the Lord needs them and he will send them right away. This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. Say to the daughter of Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle, riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. The disciples went and did just as Jesus instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt, placed their cloaks on them, and Jesus sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees, spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest!" When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." Jesus entered the temple area, drove out all those who were buying and selling there. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the benches of those selling doves. "It is written," he said to them, "my house will be called a house of prayer, but you are making it a den of robbers." The blind and the lame came to him at the temple and he healed them. But, verse 15, but when the chief priests and the teachers of the law saw the wonderful things he did, and the children shouting in the temple area. Look at what the children in the temple area were shouting. "Hosanna to the Son of David." They were indignant. The chief priests, who are rigging a trial for Jesus to have him crucified by the Romans. The enemies, the enemies of the Lord are saying, do you hear what these children are saying? Look at verse 16. The enemies of the Lord say, do you hear what these children are saying about you? And Jesus replied, yes. He said, yes. He hears them. Now Jesus is thinking because of his songbook. Because Jesus rifles through his songbook. He knows it. He sings it. He's got it memorized. And he gets this sense that we are having a Psalm 8 moment right here. Because from the mouths of children, the foes will be silenced. Here's his foes, the chief priests. And they say, do you hear these children? And look what Jesus says. He quotes Psalm 8. He quotes this lyric from a song that he knows and loves. Yes, yes, I hear the children. Have you never read, from the lips of children and infants, you have ordained praise? In other words, this should set you back a little bit to think about. Jesus knows Psalm 8, and he knows that Psalm 8 is a psalm about, O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Do you know what these children are saying? And Jesus says, yes. In other words, he understands himself to be the majestic Lord. And he accepts their praise. He accepts their praise. In fact, he quotes the Greek translation about out of that the children have ordained, God has ordained praise in the children. So that's my best attempt. I understand it better after reading what Jesus says about it than just reading it itself. Maybe another sense about it is you've got this majesty and glory and above the heavens, and then you've got the beauty and the splendor of God in something so tiny and so weak and so frail. The highest of the highs and the weakest of the weak is God's majesty displayed. And then he goes on, when I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars. I don't know if anybody was up early this morning or out late last night, but it was a meteor shower, shooting stars all over the place, multiple, just flying all over the place. God up there having a blast, finger painting for us to see his majesty. When I consider the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him? If this is in the part of the book that's from David. David wrote this. Think about Shepherd David. Think about how much time he spent out under the stars. And he's writing songs about being under the stars and reflecting on God. Now think about what you and I know from science, from the massive telescopes that we have. I mean, there's looking at the stars, and then there's looking at the stars and realizing that this earth is just such a tiny little speck of dust. Now, I think that David got that same sense, but you and I have that sense even more. In other words, this is intensified by our awareness of how truly tiny this planet is, and how truly tiny I am and you are. What are we when you consider that this galaxy is but a speck in the universe? What are we that you care about us in this little planet next to this little star in this little galaxy? Why do you care for us? We seem so insignificant and tiny in this vast, expanding universe. When I think of how massive you are and your heavens and your majesty and your work and the moon and the stars, why do you care for us? Why do you consider us at all? How do you even know us? What is humanity that you would be mindful of us, the Son of Man, that you care, that you tend to us, that you nurture us? This is a part of God's majesty. Yes, His glory is set above the heavens. And yes, He does this magnificent artwork with the universe. But part of the majesty of God, how majestic is His name, is the care that He provides to the infant. And the praise that He puts in the mouth of the infant. And then look what He does. Not only is He mindful of humans, does He care for humans. He made us just a little lower than God. You know the word there is Elohim, the same word for God. It's like a plural, generic deity. Made Him just a little lower than the heavenly beings. And crowned Him with glory and honor. So the Greek version of Psalm 8 says angels. And so we're familiar with Psalm 8 from Hebrews chapter 2 does a lot with Psalm 8. Made Him a little lower than the angels. But the Hebrew is made Him a little bit lower than God or Elohim. That's translated often heavenly beings. You made Him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned Him with glory and honor. So first of all, it's just being overwhelmed with how tiny and insignificant we are in this vast universe that You've created, God. And yet, you ranked us pretty high. Not only do You know us, care for us, You crowned us with glory and honor. We have here basically a Genesis 1 sort of story. This is Genesis 1 in a song that we've been... You have this kind of creation, the work of His fingers, and then the apex of His creation are those who God made in His image. He made all these other creatures, all these other inanimate objects, all these other living objects, living things, but there's only one living thing that He made in His image. He crowned that with glory and honor. He made us a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned us with glory and honor. He made us like Him. He made us in His likeness. He made us in His image. And we know that He made us in His likeness and in His image, what that glory and honor means by verse 6. Verse 6, now think about your Genesis story. You made Him ruler over the works of your hands. You put everything under His feet, all the flocks and herds and the beasts of the field and the birds of the air and the fish of the sea and all that swim the paths of the seas. Who are we that You care for us? Who are we that You're mindful of us? And yet, You gave us Your image and Your likeness. And You gave us this job to steward over the universe. You made us captains of the universe. What? I'm so tiny and weak and frail and insignificant, and yet You made us stewards of Your good, beautiful creation, crowning us with glory and honor to rule over the works of Your hands. What an honor and what a privilege and what status He has given us. Oh, tiny, lowly, insignificant ones. What a responsibility He's given us. Oh, tiny, lowly, insignificant ones. That we would have dominion. That we would reign. That we would rule. Oh, Lord, our Lord, how majestic is Your name in all the earth. We see His majesty, and we see His majesty in what He's done. by crowning us with glory and honor. We see His grace that He would include even us in His grand universe design, that we would be the managers. He's majestic, and He's filled with compassion and grace, and He includes us in His universe as His managers. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is Your name in all the earth. We just fall on our faces before Him, before His majesty, before His grace, before His creativity. Maybe you need to fall on your face before God. Maybe you need to acknowledge the grandeur of God, the majesty of God, the magnitude of God. Sometimes we have God as kind of a little buddy, a little old man in the sky, a little charm that we can manipulate to get our way. We can bargain with Him to try to get this or that. No, He is reality itself. He is the ground of all existence. This universe is crafted together and painted with His fingers, which just shows you how magnificent He is. We need to be in awe and fall before Him and worship Him. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is Your name in all the earth. Stand and sing.
This is my Father's world, and to my listening ears, all nature sings and round me rings the music of the spheres. This is my Father's world. I rest me in the thought of rocks and trees, of skies and seas, His hand the wonders wrought. This is my Father's world. Oh, let me never forget that.
Scott, for the lesson. It is really good to see you all here this evening, and may God bless you. Shall we pray? Our Father in heaven, we are so thankful for this planet that You've given us, for the stars that we can see and just be awed by them. Father, we're thankful for the trees and the streams and all of the beauty that surrounds us. May we make that part of our worship to You, to recognize that Your hand is in this creation. And Father, we are Your creation too. Help us to walk worthy of the calling. Help us to walk worthy of that sacrifice that Jesus made on the cross, so that we may be shining lights in a dark world. Father, forgive us, for we know and we've fallen short. Continue to give us strength with Your Spirit. In His name we pray. Amen.